I'm Melissa Rollins, and this is George Ochieng Odalo from the Korogocho slums in Nairobi, Kenya. We're fortunate to have him with us on his first visit to the U.S. He was invited to speak on a panel to the United Nations General Special Assembly session on the world drug problem about illicit drugs and substance abuse among children and youths in the slums where he was brought up and works. He's spending a week here in Littleton as a guest of a missionary volunteer who's worked with him at the Joy Village Orphanage, a ministry of the Trees of Lives. First, let's talk about what the Korogocho slums are like. In the U.S., we think of a slum as a poor area in a large city with substandard housing and high crime, certainly no place anybody would choose to live. But in Nairobi, a slum is different. A slum in Nairobi is an area of public land around dirty water streams and railroad tracks, adjacent to and surrounded by burning garbage dumps. Korogocho slums in Nairobi is a very crowded place with close to 200,000 people living in a 1 mile square area. That's like putting 5 times the population of Worcester in Maynard. George, do people in the slum typically have access to clean water, electricity, health care? What kind of houses do the people live in?
Okay, thank you very much for having me in your, sure. in your TV station, and I'm really grateful. The slums that we have in Korogocho are the kind of houses that we have are houses that are made of mud, they are houses that are made up of metals, and they are more of, I mean, their standards are very, the quality of the houses are very, very bad. They're not up to standard. You cannot compare them with those in the U.S. and other parts of the world. But what we have in Korogocho, Madare, Kibera slums, and to some extent some other slums in Africa are a little bit different with these other slums. Access to clean water is, very hard. They only have communal water whereby you go and buy like 20 liters of water. 20 liters of water can go for like around 5 shillings. That is around $0.05. I'm trying to convert it into dollars. So that is the way they have to access water. And all this lack of water contributes highly to diseases like cholera and other diseases that are waterborne. I mean, lack of water contributes to all this. Having electricity in the slums is a bit technical because people do not have that opportunity to get, I mean, they don't have enough money for them to get the right connection in the right way, because the normal connection of electricity in Kenya goes for around $30 to $50 for you to get the whole complete connection. And these are people who cannot afford the dollar a day. So tell me, where will they get around $30 to $40? Not even 30 to 40, but $300 to $400. Because in Kenya it's around 30,000, so over here it should be around $300 to $400 for the whole connection. So it's very hard for them. So what they normally have is what we call in our Swahili language, we say mlika mwizi. So mlika mwizi, I mean, in English it means like put on the light to the thief. So, so that is what, I mean, they take it, they have the black, I mean, they have the back door way of getting illegal connection of electricity, which is very risky because these houses are very much crowded in one place. And if there is a problem with connection, a house will go into fire. And cases of fire in the slums, a week cannot pass for without you hearing a house was burned, this happened as a result of electricity.
Yeah. So it's unsafe the way they're having to get their electricity because they can't afford to get it legally.
Yeah, and even for us who are working in the slums, it's very difficult because when we walk into those slums, we find it very, very unhealthy, because when it rains, you are even afraid you may be electrocuted by this, because they cross all over the roads, under the roads and over the houses. So you have to be very careful. You have to tread very careful with the people that you're going to visit. They have to know where you are passing, and you have to ask them, is it a safe place or not?
Wow.
Yeah.
Who owns the property, these houses? Do the families who live there own them? Does someone else own them? Do they pay rent?
The Korogocho Slums is a government land, and there are squatters who found themselves in that slum. Actually, when you go back, and try to get that aspect of the name Korogocho. Korogocho is it comes from one of the tribes in Korogocho. Which means a place of dirt and a place of, from the name it speaks of itself. Mm. So it belongs to the government, and there are people, we call them the land grabbers. There are people who grab this land, and they've created some small shanties, small dirty houses that people are living. And because they want to keep on oppressing the poor, they charge them like something small at the end of every month. For example, the list should be around $10 a month, and people have to struggle. There are times people have to play cat and mouse game with the owners of this land houses, because they lack, not that it's their wish, but they lack the money that they need to have, and ensure that they are in these houses. Mm. So it makes it a little bit difficult. But our constitution allows for protection of every other citizen. You ought to have a good house. You ought to have a good place. But because of the corruption incidences that are happening back at home, the poor people, and they are the most oppressed, they lack these chances to ensure that they can access this. Only the rich who can grab and steal from the government are the ones who enjoy the luxurious life of living in a good condition house.
So you are constitutionally entitled to a comfortable life, more comfortable life, but because of the political corruption, you aren't getting it.
Yes, because, okay, to some extent it's yes, because if the government utilizes what is there properly, everyone has that right. And based on my experience with kids, it's enshrined in the Constitution that every kid is entitled to good protection, and the good protection comes in terms of good shelter and good housing. But because of all that is happening, all this happening, it has become very difficult for them to be able to provide this. Because from the taxes that people are paying, from the revenues that the government is collecting, they are enough to ensure that people have good houses. They are enough to ensure that these people have good education. If I can just give a good example of education, the government, my government, I feel bad when I share about this. My government has put it very clear that they are offering free education. And the free education that they're talking about, it is not actually very free, because they've only waived for a tuition fee. And the tuition fee that has been waived, a parent has to provide stationery for these kids. Mm. A parent has to provide uniform for these kids. There is no child who can go to school without putting something into the stomach. So it becomes very difficult for education to become actually very free, as they talk about it. And then when you go into the school administration wants you to provide some extra fee, the PTA teacher, because the Teacher Service Commission in Kenya does not have that capacity and mandate to employ enough teachers. So it becomes the responsibility of the school to hire extra teachers to come in and support, it becomes the burden of this parent. So at the end of each and everything, you'll end up paying something extra, which is more or less the same with paying school fees just the normal way.
Right. Yeah. So it's not really a free education.
It's not, for me, it's not a free education. Mm-hmm. And I feel so bad because were it not for me to be able to go through high school and right now I just did my college, I would have been in a different, I don't know where I would have been right now, because education has transformed me and made me who I am. So if these kids can be denied that opportunity to get education, I mean, their world is doomed. I mean, they don't have anywhere they could go. They don't have anywhere that they would turn to and make their future bright.
What are the homes like for these kids? Is it a family with a mother and a father and kids in the same house? Or what is the family structure like for most of these kids?
The family structure is like they have like a 10 feet, do I call it, like a 10 feet by 10, I think it's 10 meters by 10 meters square. And that is where they're living. I mean, it's a single room with the father and the mother. That is the same place that they have a sitting room, the same place that they have a kitchen, the same place that they have bedroom. And I mean, it's just, it makes me very difficult to explain it. But basically, it's a small room that everyone has to be in that room in order to make sure that, because having an extra room, it means that you'll have to pay an extra fee. Mm-hmm. Having like, $10, another $10, I mean, it's very expensive. And these are people who, in a day, they hardly get that opportunity to make or earn a dollar in a day. So they have to struggle. Getting a dollar in a day in the slums is very hard. So these are people who, they have to work extra hard. So the lesser they earn, they have to make sure that they save it for the parents to get something that they can pay at the school, to make sure that they pay the legal electricity, because the legal electricity is paid. The money that they are, the water that they have, the running waters in the community around, they are paying for it. They have to provide food. They have to provide clothing. They again have to provide for house rent. So it becomes very difficult, although it's a small place, but it plays a very big role in the community. Yeah.
Is it safe? Who fights crime? Who keeps you safe in the slums? Do you have police?
Yes, there are policemen who work in these slums. But talking about crime and this other, let me call them social evil, it becomes very difficult, because the situation forces you to do what you don't expect. For example, based on my own story, when I was a boy, I mean, I was brought up in the slums, and at around the age of 11, 12 there, my parents divorced, and I went with my mother. And according to the African culture, it's supposed that you're supposed to support your father as a male person. So I felt like, let me just go against it, because I find security, I find restoration, I find hope through my mom, because she was there standing with us. And I felt like, let me walk with her, let me go with her. And many people were like, you're doing the wrong thing. And then the next thing that happened, she got sick. She gets admitted at the hospital. So I ended up being the only person heading our family. I had to provide food. I had to provide rent. I had to provide clothing for my brothers. I had to make sure that I go to the hospital to look after my mom. How is she doing? And all this. So all this situation forced me into street life. So I had to go to the garbage, get something that I can bring back home so that my brothers and sisters can have something to put on the table. And why do I bring all these stories? I bring all these stories because when I was in that situation, a friend of mine invited me, told me, why put on dirty clothes? I mean, why go into street life? Can you come and I teach you something good? that will make you earn quick money. And I was like, quick money, what is it? He never wanted to tell me, only to realize later, some months later, that he has been killed by the mob justice because he was doing criminal activities. So I felt very bad because he was my peer, he was one of my best friends. At times he used to come home and give me like some few coins to sustain myself. So this makes, I mean, the situation that people are living in makes them do things like criminal activities. Young girls as early as around 10, 11, 12 engage in prostitution because they engage in prostitution because the life in the houses are hectic, they're hell. So you want to walk out. And it's more or less the same with the other girls who opt to get married at a tender age because the situation in the house, the mother wants to provide, the father wants to provide, but they lack the resources to provide. So you end up looking for a wealthy boy or a wealthy young man who would come in and pick you. And even the parents don't even care about the dowry and all that. Because if the young man is willing to provide dowry, well and good. If you're not willing to provide, they say, thank you and God bless, because you've relieved us from a certain burden. So it's a common trend. Young people doing, I normally love calling them social evil. They do drug and substance abuse. They do criminal activities. They do the prostitution and all these other sorts of things, because they want to make sure that they have something on the table. And then you ask about how safe it is. So the slum area definitely is not safe. It's not safe because everyone wants to earn a living. There are people who want to earn a living by ensuring that anyone who passes along the route, they get hold of him and pickpocket him. And I mean, all this to ensure that they have something. There was a time I was walking through the slum and someone was telling me, you know how much you're worth? And I was like, what do you mean? And he was telling me, if right now I would have get hold of you, you're worth around $5. And I was like, what do you mean? $5, that means they've already budgeted for my clothes, what I was wearing, and they would get on my neck and just remove everything, and they go and sell them. Because, I mean, the situation has made them to be hopeless. They've made them to look like desperate. I mean, not like, but they're desperate. They're looking for that opportunity. Anything that would come across, they would grab it and take and run with it. I mean, and run with it to make a better living out of it. So that is the situation. There are policemen who work there, who works in the slums. But even the policemen, there are certain regions that they cannot go to. Mm. Because these young men have been able to access guns. These young men use knives, they use machetes. So when they want to attack, they're desperately looking for anything that they can take. And they, if they got that opportunity, they'll use the force that they have within their reach to ensure that they capture what they want. So it's to some extent, it's a little bit safe if you have an insider, but you have to work with the police, which makes it very difficult because how many people will afford working with the police? I myself, last year, my house was robbed. I mean, I felt very bitter. And I was like, everything that I had struggled all along to buy, they came in and it was taken off from me. And I was like, this one will not deter me from working for this community. This one will not change my perception. This one will not change my mentality of ensuring that I deliver what is needed for this community. Because I was brought up in the slums and I believe it's I myself who will bring the change. Because if we wait for people to bring the change, I have Melissa and I tell Melissa, come to Korogocho and bring a change. It will be a little bit very, very difficult for you to bring the change. But unless we give opportunity to people who have been brought up in the slum area to work it out, I mean, it won't work out. But if we give them an opportunity, it will work out. So I don't give up. At times, they get on my neck, they pickpocket me, they do this, they do that. But I'm used to, There was a time I had a student who came over for an attachment with my with my organization. And the first time we went to the slum, we met a young man who was looking for me very much. For me, first of all, I was like, what is it? George, I've been looking for you. So I had to be very careful. Maybe he wanted to rob me. Or so I had to be patient. And I sat down with him and I was like, okay, what do you want? And he told me, George, I want some assistance from you. And I said, right now, I don't have money to give you. I would really love to give you whatever I have. But unfortunately, I don't have anything that I can share with you. And he said, George, I'm not looking for money. I'm looking for someone like you who can sit down with me and hear my story. And I was like, okay. So we started talking and talking and talking, and he was like, he was giving me stories and incidents, some of which I saw on the national TV. And he was like, do you remember that scenario? It was in the news. I was shot. And he shows you a bullet wound. As you talk, he shows you another bullet wound. He shows you another bullet wound. And he tells you, George, I mean, where I have reached, I feel like I don't deserve to be in this world. I feel like I don't deserve to live another life. I am hopeless. So most of my work deals with restoring these hopes. I mean, telling them that there is hope, and the only hope that we have is hope in God. So if you don't have hope, you don't have any future in you. So that is how it is. But to some extent, it's not that much safe. So if, for example, Melissa is coming with me or Melissa is coming to visit me, I have to go and get some security to escort me through. We work with you to ensure that your safety is okay, because I don't want your government to be on my neck that Melissa came into your country and nothing was done, and George, we are closing this organization. Oh, yes.
Wow. So tell us about some of the kids that you've worked with. First of all, this work you do is only part of your day. Mm-hmm. Tell us what your day is like now, and you still live in the slums.
My day starts as early as 4:30 in the morning. So 4:30, I'm awake. I have to prepare myself. By 5:30 in the morning, I have to wake up, and I have a motorbike that I ferry people from one place to another place. I mean, to earn something small that can keep me, can make me earn a living. I mean, in a just way. So I'll have to do this up to around midday. And then, because I don't have donors who can support my organization so far, but I will not have to wait for donors to come so that I can keep on transforming the lives of people. So I have to do that up to half of my day. And then from around from noon onwards, I have to go to the office, sort out 1, 2, 3 things that I need to ensure that things are running, to ensure that the people that want my services are there. At times, I feel tired because I go there by around 1. You find a queue of young girls, women, young boys and youths. They want to listen to you. They want to talk to you. So you shift from being a motorbike driver and become a counselor and now start listening to their stories. And sometimes it goes up to around 10 in the evening. So 10 at night, I mean, I got to put up my place, my stuff together, get into my motorbike, go back into my house. When I go back into my house, my daughter needs me, because I'm married with one daughter, so the daughter needs me, the wife needs me, and we have to share a little bit. At times, I'm even forced to go with my daughter to the office, because I want her to also understand that if you have problem, you're not the only person who have problem. There are many people who have much more problem than what you think you have. But it's really giving me a challenge to serve more people, because if I could have someone who can be in a position to support my organization, I mean, provide the office rent for the organization, and provide kind of my salary at the end of the month that can be able to help me and help my family, I mean, it would have given me a whole day to work with people and give me an easier time to walk even through, because I walk, I do home visits in the slum, but I don't do as much home visits as I would want to do, because I'm only limited to a given time. At times I hope to start doing it in the morning, and then from midday onwards I do my motorbike job, but it becomes at least a challenge at times, because in the morning when you do your job, someone stops you. And as a community worker, you have to listen to them. Mm. So I stop a bit, we start talking. I end up spending 2 hours addressing one person, and I have to sort it out. And if I skip it, I mean, it will become very hard and very difficult.
Right. So you're trying to balance enough income to support your family.
Yes.
And do the work that you want to do.
Yes, and actually what I do, I don't charge. I mean, I do it freely. I don't tell people that when you come for counseling, when you come for my services, or when you bring your child to my program, you have to pay this, you have to pay this. No, I'm doing it freely, and I do it with the love of Christ. I mean, I tell them and I share with them the love of God, that I was given this thing freely, and I have to share with you freely. Yeah.
Wonderful outlook. Now, you talked a little bit about, you know, you people you've met, kids you've met that don't have hope for the future. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us how you try to instill that hope, and have you had success doing that with kids, and have you seen kids pick themselves up and move forward in a positive way?
Yes, I have several success stories that I have to tell. Basically, in the course of the week, I do a lot of home visits. I mean, people come into my office. I have to address that, the issues that they have. And then at around 3 or 4, I have scheduled with the schools around. I go and talk to these kids, because my main reason of creating school outreach program was that I don't want to see kids dropping out of school. As much as their parents struggle to pay for them school fees and all that, I don't want them to drop out of school. So I feel I keep on going to these schools and talking to these kids by giving them my own story, telling them that I was here, I've made it, and I've been able to scale heights where no one would have thought a boy who was born and brought up in the slum would be. So I try to give them that hope and tell them that you can make it. You can make it irrespective of the challenges that you're facing. And apart from that, that goes from Monday to Friday. So Monday to Friday, I have like 2 sessions for my organization. The parents meeting, or the youths, or the kids who come for the session in my office. And then from 3 to around 6, I go to the nearby schools and install hope in their lives. Apart from that, over the weekends, I have a program for kids whereby I bring these kids together and talk to them, because I cannot be able to reach everyone when I go to the school outreach program. So I have to develop a mechanism that I'm able to reach the youths who are not in school and the young kids who are not in school. So on Saturday, we have a community hall in the slums that we were given by the school. I went back to the school that I went to, and I told them that this is what I'm doing. Is there a way that you can be of great assistance to me and my work to ensure that you have such a product like me in the school? And they were like, good, we will give you a room. So I've been given a room by the school at no cost to ensure that I meet with my kids there, and we talk and share a lot of stuff. And when I meet with these kids, I keep on telling them my story. I keep on telling them that there is another life. And then when the kids come together, I mean, you know, talking is not fun for the kids. So we have to do a bit of drawing. At times, like last month, we did an artistic work. I was telling them that I've been talking to you about the life that you want, and you've been also responding back about the situation that you want. So today I want you to express it by having artistic bit of it. And they were like, yes, the house that I want, the car that I want, the different things that they want. But I gave them the two pictures. Right, the slum that we are in right now, and the slum that you want in. So they had to draw it was like some of them were just drawing some funny stuff, rubbish, but they were very much excited to draw the slum that they want, I mean, the life that they want. So they were very much touched. And if you look at the two pictures, the others who drew alcohol and bottle of alcohol and these drugs, and they had to cancel. So that tells you that they're not very much impressed with the issues of drug and substance abuse. And again, these kids that I worked with, I was able to identify some of them come from a drug-related background, which is my specialty, illicit drug and substance abuse background. So I've been able to identify them, and I've developed a model that I'm working out with them, because it has become very difficult for me to reach out the parents who are drug addicts. So I'm using the kids as a bridge to reach the parents who have been very intelligent to disappear from my session. So I'm training these kids, I'm developing their self-esteem, their facilitation skills, and every session that we have with them, they have to go back at home, either 5 minutes before meal or 5 minutes after meal, they have to share with their parents what they were taught. And slowly by slowly, they get to engage the parents, and through the self-esteem, facilitation skills, and later they come to start talking about drug and substance abuse. Dad, you know, a family that uses drug and substance abuse looks like this. And a family that does not use drug and substance abuse look like this. Daddy, this is the family that we want. You know, that is indirect provocation to the, I mean, the kid will be provoking the parent indirectly. So that is another mechanism that I use. And through it, I keep on telling them my story, and I keep on telling them, this is where I was. This is the desk that I sat on. This is the school that I went to. And I've made it. So you can also still make it. Yeah.
Great. And tell us about some of the kids who have made it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just the other day, last year, I had cases of five girls that I took to vocational training. One of them, actually, when I was given her story, she was brought up... her family, I mean, the father and the dad were together, and then the father died. Then the mother started making illicit brew, the homemade brew, which is not standard, which is not healthy. So this girl had to drop out of school because the father was the provider of all the basic needs. So she had to come in and help the mother sell this. So she used to be, I mean, she encountered cases of gender-based violence, because these young men who came in to drink wanted to sleep with her, wanted to rape her, and she was every now and then people get to beat her up, and the mother doesn't care because she's told that you are on the wrong side, you are the one who never wanted to serve the customers. And it's not serving the customer, it is the self-interest of these people. They go there with, after drinking a few bottles, they feel like she's the right woman. And the girl by then was around 15 years. I felt pity about it, and I opted to take that step. And I went and rescued the girl. She came into my office. We went through several counseling session. She had to come to my house for meals, and I made sure that I had to make sure that she doesn't get that opportunity to be exposed to this young man. She was very much attached to my wife. So my wife was like her sister, was like her mother. We kept on talking and talking, and through the little contribution that I get from the motorbike and all this other stuff, I took her to a vocational training school, and she was able to do hairdressing and beauty. And she's just almost getting through. Maybe at the end of this month, or February or next month, she will be completing her course, which for me, that is the most successful story. The other time, I had a case of a young boy who dropped out of school because he lacked school stationaries, and the parent was not able to provide. The mother used to wake the boy as early as when he comes from school. He has no time to do homework. They have to go down the river and start making illicit brew, which it is made the whole night. So when it's through, the boy has to test when it's okay. So the parent forces the child to test, is it okay? Yes, it's okay. So he has been trained in a way that he knows when it's okay and when it's not okay. So one of the teachers that was working in the school that the boy was going to called on me and told me that, George, I have a problem. This kid sleeps in the classroom the whole day when he comes here. If you don't mind, he's not willing to talk to anyone else. He's not willing to share his story with anyone else. Can you engage this boy and ensure you know what is the problem? And I prayed to God and I was like, let me have him. So I had him and he shared with me his story. At times, they're beaten by the police. When it's raining, they have to do it down by the river when it's cold. And this is a 10-year-old boy. Yeah. So I had to rescue this boy from all this. I had to stay with him because he was a total orphan. The person that he was staying with was the one who was trying to do all this, because the teachers in school knew that this is a parent who is doing this. But later I came to realize that this is a total orphan. He has no one to turn to. The person that he's turning to has turned his life into something else. He developed addiction. Mm-hmm. So I had to intervene and seek partnership with different people around, and with the small contribution that I get from the motorbike staff, I had to take him to a rehabilitation center, because I don't offer rehabilitation. So I had to take him to the rehabilitation center at least to ensure that he recovers from all this stuff, because of something that would have been catered for, something small. So we worked it out and slowly, but I used to do it in my house because I cannot afford a rehabilitation fee, which goes for like $3,000. So I had to ensure that he goes for the counseling. I offer the counseling. We move up and down with him. And slowly by slowly, he reformed. And after reforming, I had to ensure that through the little contribution that we have all around, I provide the stationery that is needed. And he had to go back to school. But again, we had to relocate him. We had to engage the auntie in a very positive way that he doesn't feel like we've done the wrong thing. Yeah. And we had to look for a different person who would stay with the kid. And the kid right now is in school. He's almost completing his 12th grade, I think in the course of this year or next year. So to me, that is a successful story. Yeah. I've engaged a number of street kids. I mean, you talk to them. I mean, through talking, you learn that their lives have been changed. And again, when I walk through the slums, I meet the parents and they're telling me, George, I'm very much proud of you. You've made my daughter to be who he is or who she is. Some of them go to the dumping site where I used to go. So when they know that this is what I'm doing, they get hold of me, George, my daughter or my son is into the dumping site. Is there a way that you can go and rescue? I'm really requesting you to do that. So I go there, have a session with them, and bring them into my office, talk a bit and share a bit. And at the end of it all, I tell them that it's not only you. You see this, you see this. In our neighborhood here, there is this boy, there is this girl who was like this, and his life has really changed. I mean, he has made it in life. So going to the dumping site does not make your life to be different. It's you to have your life and live your life to the fullest.
You have a wonderful outlook. And tell us about your faith. Have you always had a strong faith? Did you learn about God? Did you go to church when you were young? Where did this start? Where did your strength, your faith start?
You see, when I was born up, born and brought up in the slums, my family used to have a strong Christian background that they used to keep on encouraging us that we need to trust in God. We need to have our hope in God. So that was the value that my mom instilled in me. And she kept on telling me all along. Until now, she has not died. She's alive. And she keeps on telling me, my son, remember what I taught you when you were young. You need to have faith in God. You need to have hope in God. So she taught me Christian morals, Christian values. That kept me all along moving. So when they divorced, I mean, the dad went on his own, the mother went on his own, she kept on telling me, you need to have faith in God. God can help us sail through. And my testimony all along, it's based on hope, it's based on faith, it's based on forgiveness, it's based on the fruits of the Holy Spirit and the love for the poor. I mean, you love the people that you work with. And I normally say I would not prefer to, because all along I've been traveling. I came to America this year. Last year I was in Austria. And some of the people that I meet in the slums, they tell me, I cannot go to America and come back. I cannot go to Austria and come back. But because, I mean, God has installed a good testimony in me that I need to share with the world. I need to tell them that there is hope, there is this. So if I come to America and opt to stay here, who will bring hope to these kids? No one will bring hope. It is me to go back and tell them that there is hope. And actually, after here, I'll still go back. I'll not stay in America. I prefer being in my hood than any other place. Yeah.
How were you chosen to speak with the UN? How did they find out about you down there in the slum?
You know, God works in different ways. When I was doing my work in the slums, I mean, I kept on doing what I was doing, and I was like, I never looked at how much I'm going to earn, how much I'm going to attract people to come and do and support my work. I was very much focused with what I was doing. I said, I'm not doing it for money. I'm doing it for the love of God. So I kept on doing what I was doing. And when I was doing the school outreach program, I organized an annual convention. I used to call it an annual convention, because as much as I kept on sharing about the love of God and the hope, telling these kids about myself, I felt like there is need of bringing other people into the picture. People who have similar experiences that can help them think of the future. So I organized a student convention, and all the schools that I was working with, I invited them and they came together. The first session had like 300 kids. And they were like, they're here. And when I was organizing, I was like, God, here they are. In your word, when Jesus was preaching and a multitude came, the disciples were a little bit afraid. Where will we get this? Where will we get this? And you provided. God, they're here. And God, I want you to provide. And God provided. The first event I organized, some of the people that I invited came in and they were like, George, the students are here. We have something small. Can you buy for them something? Because I never budgeted for that. And they were very much touched and they said, buy for them something that they can drink, because we cannot keep telling them and talking to them. And they have nothing to eat. It doesn't make sense. And God provided. So I kept on doing this, and I did. Every year I do it. So one of the years I was organizing that, I looked for a partnership with a government institution that deals with drug and substance abuse. And they were not able to give me money. They gave me materials to help me in my work. And I was like, thank you very much, because I can't afford to buy this, but you've opted to give me, thank you. So after the session, they sent someone unknowingly. I mean, the guy was not like in a car. He was not like a guest. So he came in and he realized what we were doing. And I said, well, good. So the guy sent report to another organization in Sweden, and this organization sent me an email that, George, we are very much impressed with what you are doing. We saw you at your student convention, and I was like, you are here. I didn't see any white guy. So I was like, okay. And I was like, I think this is a scam. So they had to send me photos that these are the photos that we took when you were here. And I was like, God. So they told me that we will be working with you. We will be organizing for a training, and we would really love to have you come to the training. We are partnering with a government agency. So they organized the training, and our organization was the topic of the day. I mean, every reference was being made. You see that organization, you see that organization. So based on that, after the training, they organized for a conference in Sweden. And they said that, George, we want you to come and share the amazing work that you're doing over there. And I was like, the first time to go into a plane, because I never thought that in the slums I would really make it and board a plane. It was really very hard. So I was like, an opportunity has come. And I shared with my mom, Mom, I'm going abroad. And she was like, you are kidding. And I was like, Mom, God has done it. So I'm going to... And she was like, are you going to America? I told her, not America, but I'm going to Sweden. And she said that, God, I'm praying that God will make a way. You are going to amaze people with your stories there. So I went to Sweden the first time. I shared with people my story, and they were like, good, we really love that. So the second time, that was in 2012. So in 2014, when they're organizing for the same conference, they invited me now. Because many people requested to see me, many people requested, many media houses there wanted to have an interview of me. So they requested the organization to call me. So when I went there, I was like kind of like a celebrity a bit. Because in 2012, I also got an audience to greet a queen. Because in the slums, you are like a queen. I was like a queen. It was just an amazing stuff. Actually, after greeting the queen, I never wanted anyone to greet me, because you feel like this is a very special hand. So in 2012, it was the same. I got that opportunity, went there, and it was just an amazing. So luckily, there were some officials from the UN who came in to the forum. And they told me that, later they told me that, George, we are amazed with what you're doing and all this. And we are organizing for the UNGAS. UNGAS is United Nations General Assembly special session on world drug problem, which is going to take place here in New York in April. So they said that we are looking for the contribution of grassroots organization, the people who are working in the field of drug and substance abuse, which is a big problem in the slums mm-hmm. there. So they told me that we would really love you to come over to Austria and make your contribution. So I went there, I shared my work, and everyone was like, I love what you're doing. I'm really amazed with what you're doing. We would really love to work with you. So last year, towards the end, they make an announcement that they wanted people to come, the speakers to come to the conference. And I said to myself, I looked at it and I was like, this is good, but the UN, not really. Let me try it, but I'm not so sure. The first time I tried and I was halfway, I left it and I was like, let it be. I'm not so sure if these people will take me because I'm from the slums. That is one. Two, I'm not that much educated. I have only a diploma. And I know there are people with masters, people with PhDs and doctorate, whatever. So I won't really make it. And God used different people. The people that saw this gave me phone calls and they were like, "George, apply for that thing, apply for that thing." So I took my time and I applied for it, and luckily I was shortlisted, and later I was told that, "George, you've been selected to come and speak at the UN General Assembly about what you're doing and all that." Yeah. To me, it was, I never believed it because I never would even thought that one day I would come to America. I mean, it was just a dream in my dreamland. So I said, well and good, I'm coming to America. So I came in. I never believed it until that time that the Secretary General of the UN came into the room. I was like, I think this is now a reality because I've never seen Ban Ki-moon one-on-one. He has been coming to Kenya, but in big hotels, sure, meeting the president, and in the slums, he's never thought of coming into the slums. So when I saw him and I was like, God, now this is a reality. And I see the UN top official, they came for the opening ceremony. And then after the opening ceremony, they went into the audience. And now it was time for us to sit in the panel and talk to them about the challenges that we are facing. I was a little bit nervous, I mean, but I prayed God, and my wife was on my side texting me, sending me messages, have courage, they are human beings like you, don't worry. I mean, so I did it, and I was able to tell the people about my concerns, especially the issue of legalization of marijuana. Back at home, and how it affects the people there, and even sharing the same aspect of the same here in America. Because the issue of drug and substance abuse is a major problem, is a big problem, not only in the slums, but all over the world. And I differed with some prominent people because they were for legalization, and I told them clearly, I'm not opposing legalization, but we have to be very clear because I am for prevention. I don't want marijuana to be taken for recreational use. If it's going to be used on a medical ground, which I believe that the doctor has to give you a clear prescription that you are using this under this, that makes sense. As a pain reliever, that makes sense. For cancer patient, that makes sense to me. But on the other hand, that people want it to be legalized so that they can go to the to where drugs are being, drug store, and request, and they are not sick. That does not make sense to me, and I'm opposing that. There are people who want it for recreational use. That I'm totally against that. I'm for prevention. Let us prevent it, because in the slums, you cannot be able to get a good rehabilitation treatment. Like the case of the boy that I've told you, I myself, I cannot be able to afford the $3,000 needed for a treatment. And these are people who cannot afford a dollar in a day. So tell me, if we legalize marijuana, they get exposed to it, they get addicted to it. It's like we are giving them a license to death. So I'm really against that. I said it, and I repeated it, and I emphasized, and I said that legalization for me, it's a big no. Because right now it is illegal in the slums, but the harm is more than the harm is just a bit, the harm is so big that we cannot be able to control. And I ask, I mean, if we make it legal, right now it's legal, but the harm is more than good. The harm has created is bad more than the good. So tell me, if we make it legal, do you want us to walk in the rooftops? And because the people who will be using, the young men who have no hope, I mean, they feel hopeless, they'll be using it. And, I mean, they will be fighting people up and down. I mean, it will be very difficult. And then the harm that it has makes them feel like as early as 7 or 8, you meet, I mean, a drunkard, someone who would have been working somewhere to earn a living, because they have no hope. The only thing that they see is, I have nothing to do, I am hopeless, let me go get this stuff and keep off living from the reality. Mm-hmm. And if you walk along the slums, you'll find people sleeping on the roads. You'll think that they're dead. I mean, you'll think that they're sick. They're not sick, they're drunken. And I'm really working out on a program based on support from well-wishers to develop a program and a concept that I'll be able to engage the youths and the young mothers in the slums to kind of train them, empower them with skills that will help them start some small income generating activities to sustain themselves. Because as much as others engage in prostitution, others engage in criminal activities, the situation is what forces them. But if you can empower them and give them a platform, train them and tell them that with this, for example, if they have like around $50 or $10, $100, $50 to $100, you tell them, I want you to start an income generating activity here. I want you to set up a business. I mean, they'll be able to earn a living, and their kids won't be able to go and do prostitution, and because they will be able to put something on top of the table. And for the young men who are walking around, you engage them and tell them that I'm willing to take you to a vocational training school, and if we'll be able to have something small, I help you set up something that you're going to do. Because for the girl that I took to vocational training, I'm really worried because right now she's almost getting through. But again, if I don't look for other avenues, this girl will come back to the slums and I will have done a zero act. Mm-hmm. So I'm really working on that. Although I'm finding it very difficult in terms of having finances to support my initiative, but I'm praying to God that God will make a way that people will be able to come on board and support the whole initiative to make it move from one level to another level. Yeah.
Well, we wish you the best. We thank you for your time. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
Okay, I'm really grateful, first of all, but I lack words to express my joy. Being in America is wow. But the key thing that I keep on telling people is that as much as you may have all the riches in the world, if you don't have God, I mean, you're doomed. God is the source of everything. Many people have the rich, but they don't have peace. In the slums, people are poor, but they have a drop in an ocean of peace. As much as they continue struggling and all that, but the key thing is that to have hope that keeps you alive, hope that keeps you moving from one level to another level. Because these people in the slums, they are poor. The only thing that they need is hope. And as much as we keep on ignoring the poor people, I mean, we won't be able to move a notch higher. People would have not known about George if someone did not restore a hope in my life. A nun who came into my life realized and saw what I was doing, I mean, the potential in me, and said that, George, I'm willing to help you do this. And it was done. And here I am, a different George. I mean, I was able to be, I mean, she gave me a platform to realize who I am. Many kids in the slums, they want to realize who they are, but they don't have that person who can turn to and tell them that there is hope. There is this. As much as George is there, George cannot be able to reach the entire slum. There are many slums. I can reach the whole Korogocho, yes. But how about Kibera? How about Mathare slums? How about these other slums where young people are dying without hope? So what is needed most is hope to these hopeless people. I mean, that is the key thing that they need. And it's a request that I'm making to people. They come to Korogocho slums. We will organize for security. They will be under police security. And they see the situation that I'm talking about. I really love people to experience. They come to Korogocho. They see through my organization, Slum Child Foundation, they'll be able to learn a lot. They'll be able to see the reality about, as much as we are talking about people sleeping in the streets, people living in a metallic house, in a very weird situation, they would really come and see. I really invite them to come and see and feel inspired where I was brought up and where I am right now, and the platform and the opportunity that I got.
Well, you are inspiring to us, and we offer you our prayers of peace for your people, for your neighbors, the people you work with, the kids you work with, and our prayers of continued hope. Okay. Thank you very much for being with us. It's really nice to meet you.
Thank you. Good. Mm-hmm.